I hope I didn't miss anybody. If I did, the Lord's better at that than me anyway, so he already knew. We call out for the benefit of each other, for the encouraging and the strengthening one another, but his hand is not shortened. So we are going to start in Lazarus. I don't remember, can somebody fill me in whether we actually started into that or not? I've taught this passage a few times, but I don't remember if we actually started reading it this time or not. Do you remember, Willie?
I do not. I don't think that we did.
All right. Well, if we can't remember, then we need to do it again anyway, right?
Absolutely.
All right. Chapter 11 of John. For those of you that have not been here or have missed out or do not know, we have been going through a study of the miracles of Jesus. And I have truly, truly been blessed through this. It has truly shown me, you know, even non-Christians, even Hollywood, even secular people, they are aware of the miracles of Jesus. You see it on, you can go anywhere. You go to Tarpon Springs, you go to any little touristy area up in the mountains, out on the beach, and they have plaques that have cute little sayings on them that will even poke fun at or mention the miracles of Christ. We see little jokes on Facebook about Jesus turning the water into wine and has nothing to do with the truth or the gospel, but poking fun at it. So even the unsaved and the atheist and the unchurched and the worldly are familiar with the miracles of Christ.
And nobody gets threatened to be killed?
but I have, so we as Christians that have been in the church for a long time, we kind of know them backwards and forwards, or so we thought. But I have truly been blessed when we have broken these down and gone through them, the depth behind the actual miracle. What was going on? You know, I always say at work, if somebody comes in to tell me something and I'm in the middle of something, I will say, hold on just a minute, let me finish this. I am not too good of a multitasker. So I will half listen to you, but I will not hear the depth of what you're saying to me. So, you know, so I have, at times, I'll have to prioritize. If somebody comes in to tell me something, I'll have to decide whether what they have to say is more important than what I'm doing so that I can give my full attention to those things. And so, as we've been studying the miracles of Jesus, I am just, it's almost just taken my breath away a couple times about how much was going on behind the scenes of what he was doing. It wasn't just somebody receiving healing in their physical body. And if you've been here through most of the series, we have pulled out so many different things. What he was teaching, who he was reaching, what he was saying, what he was not saying. And I've just truly, truly been blessed that we've looked at this in depth and we've seen that a picture of Jesus that we say we know, but sometimes we forget, and that is even the little details behind the scenes when we don't know what's going on. When we have a big picture in front of us and that's all we see, not only is he taking care of that big picture, but all those little things behind us and those little things surrounding us that we don't even, may not even know what's going on or who's watching or who's listening or who needs something. I think about that and I think, throughout the time that I have been saved, where he has done miracles in my life, I never thought about who besides me was receiving. Those people watching on. You know, because we are very self-centered. We try not to be. We know it's not Christ-like, so we work on that. We strive to be others-centered. But it is a struggle for most of us. It is a battle for most of us not to be self-centered. And so I've just been very blessed to know that the times that the Lord has moved in my life seemed like they were just for me, when the truth thing is that he may have just been using the situation in my life, not for me, but for those watching on, or for those looking on. And I just, he is a, you know, those of you that know Ashley Davis, she does this little, like a Caribbean mix up, or I don't know what you call it.
Medley.
Thank you. like this little calypso. And I love it. There's one part in it that she's a, he's a super natural God. And I love it. He's a miracle working, delivering God. And your miracle is not just for you, but everybody that's watching on.
Mm.
We're starting in John. We're going to talk about Lazarus. Chapter 11, starting at the first verse.
What book is this, John? I'm sorry.
John.
John
11, 1. Now a certain man was sick, named Lazarus, of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sisters sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. Now, I'm going to pull a little something out here that struck me. Now, I'm not saying that what they said was bad. I'm just telling you how that where it led me in my thinking. Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. And I thought about this and I thought, first of all, it's the Lord. He doesn't need to, you know, he already knew. Of course, they were human. They were struggling with just what kind of Christ he was, what kind of Son of God he was. But it's almost like they said that to add a little weight to it. The one you love is sick. And I thought, we do the same thing. We try to weight our prayers so that the Lord will prioritize them. Okay?
True.
Lord, I need you to help me feel better this morning. I have to preach, Lord. I'm the preacher. I'm the teacher, Lord. You've got to touch my body. We do. We weight our prayers. You know, we don't we? Now, I'm not saying it's a bad thing.
We put limits on God. We should.
True. So if there are no limits on God, then we shouldn't have to put weight on God either. But we do, don't we? Now, Lord, he's gone into North Korea to spread your gospel, Lord. When nobody else will, Lord, you protect him. I'm not saying that that's a bad thing. Please don't get me wrong. I'm just telling you how my mind goes when I read through some of these. But I think we do. We try to add weight to our requests, or try to remind the Lord of how important this should be to him when there are no limits to him. The man in the gutter face down, I'm sorry, in his own vomit is as important to the Lord as we are. Now, that doesn't mean, you know, that there's not instances in Scripture where the Bible actually calls out the love the Lord had for somebody. So, but that did stand out to me that they're like, go tell Jesus the one you love is sick.
Isn't John the beloved?
There you go. All right, verse 4. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. But now listen to what it says. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. He loved them. He is love. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and her Lazarus, but he brings a little bit of tough love here because he doesn't cater to their immediate wish. Oh, if we could learn that as parents.
Amen.
If we could learn that as parents. Now, Jesus loved Martha and his sister. So wouldn't we, in our human understanding, expect it to say, so he rushed right to their request to comfort them and let them know that Lazarus was going to be okay. It's not what it says. So Dobson wasn't the first originator of tough love. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the place where he was. See, true love is not catering to somebody's wishes. It's showing up to meet somebody's needs.
Amen.
When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was, when it might even be tough. And that goes over into our witnessing to others as well. Sometimes I believe that we, and I've said this before, you've heard me use this analogy time and time again, and I will use it as long as I'm here on earth. We used to teach all hellfire and brimstone. The church used to teach all hellfire and brimstone, and grace was nowhere to be found. Now we teach all grace, and we have forgotten that there is still hellfire and brimstone. There has to be a balance, and we are not the one that decides where that balance is. Therefore, we have to operate and walk in the Spirit as the oracles of God, opening our mouth, letting the Lord fill it, and be very, very careful how we minister to others. We are caught up so much in the grace movement that I'm afraid that we don't give tough love. We have people that, like I shared with you last week, that are walking around dead in their sins, who are not even saved, who do not understand the love of Christ, and we're petting them and going, "That's okay, God's love is gracious." Well, that is true. God's love is giving and merciful and gracious toward those that repent. Grace isn't found where there's no repentance. There has to be a repentance. There has to be an acknowledgement. That's not my words. That's the KJV. And all those before and all those after. And so sometimes tough love when our unsaved and even our saved church people, our family that we're ministering to, when they say, this has to happen right now. Sometimes we have to be the firm word of reasoning, and sometimes we have to be the one that just pets them with grace. And so we have to be prayed up with the Lord, know what the Word says, know what the Lord says, so that we can minister properly. Because Jesus didn't rush right away to there, and they're hurting. They are hurting. This is their brother. He is sick. These are two women that have been, Jesus has spent time in their home. He has spent time in their home and he has ministered to them. He has taught them. Can you imagine sitting at the feet of Christ as he speaks to you and learning from him? These two women had that. Now they are hurting. They have a brother that they love, and they have a Jesus that can fix it. And so they call out to him, and he doesn't go right away. Because he knows that what they need to learn and what they need to see is so much greater than the fleshly comfort they need in the moment. That's huge.
Because he knew the end result.
He knew the end result. We could carry that over into us being in trials and tribulations and tough times and us thinking, "Lord, why am I not being delivered right now? Come quickly, Lord. Why?" And it could be that he's purposely holding back because there's something greater for us to receive at the end of that trial. That's what was happening here. He purposely held back for the greater understanding, the greater lesson.
Well, and I think sickness, more than anything, is something that that resonates with me, that resonates with us. In terms of the example I'm giving is like when Shiloh was sick, mm-hmm. and when you look at Jamie's daughter, Chloe. Now, the struggle that you went through, you were very open about that.
Right.
Pastor's approach, similar to Jesus, said, "Oh, just relax. I got this." you know, and that worked out fine. Jamie's baby still has cancer, going through a treatment. Not sure why that happens, but just trusting that God is still in control, and that's the evidence of things not seen faith. Walking by faith and not by sight, and that sometimes is difficult, and that's why it's so important to be around godly people that will encourage you in the Word and lift you up and say, hey, look, keep the faith, keep the faith, keep the faith, keep the faith. That's sometimes a difficult thing to do, and it's so foreign for people that can't see. How could somebody, I mean, that's your daughter. Aren't you concerned?
Right.
What are you, insensitive? You know.
And it's tough when you're in this, you know what, here's funny. We believe so many things readily. And of course, I know it's, you know, the whole faith thing, but July 17th, Clearwater, Florida. I know fall is coming. I know that while I am burning up, sweating, can't breathe because it's so hot outside, miserably hot. It's hot. I'm sweating. It's not. The circumstances are real. The struggle is real, people. It's July in Clearwater. But I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, fall is coming.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll make statements like, "Woo! Another summer we have to get through. If we can get this summer under our belt, hottest summer on record, if we can get this one through our belt, you know, or let's say August, September, woo, October's coming, we'll get a break." And then every year Scott will say, "Well, we beat another summer when we get that first cool snap." We don't doubt fall's coming. No matter how hot we are, we don't doubt cooler weather's coming, even in Florida where there is no cool weather. And so in our circumstances, though, because it's so hot in here, I'm sweating, the struggle is real, do we have to say, "Ooh, if we can just hold on a couple more, a few more, if we can just hold on another month, we know fall is coming. If we can just hold on for whatever reason, whatever the Lord's working, if we can just hold on, we know He's going to show up. And when He does, whew, there'll be a change in the atmosphere."
My grandfather always used to say, "If you make it through December, we'll be fine. Because it's always the one with Christmas that's been the most money."
Yeah.
After that, it's...
Yeah. And you know what's funny about that is we say it every December. Mm-hmm. Even though we've conquered, some of us have conquered more than 40 Decembers. Well, as an adult, 30, close to 30 Decembers we've conquered and not gone hungry. Kids still had Christmas. Some years was better than others, but January always came. Mm-hmm. And so, but we still do it, don't we? Still say it, even though, and we do it with the Lord too. Even though He's come through for us time and time and time and time and time again, well, if we can just make it through this, if I can just see to the other side of this.
Well, the other thing is the perspective. You know, you always hear the story of Joshua. You know, Joshua goes over, they go to spy out the land, and he comes back. Him and his buddy come back and go, "Hey, we're good. It's all good."
Yeah.
The other guys are scared to death, and it's Elijah and his servant, or Elisha. You know, when Elisha knew what was up there,
mm-hmm.
but his servant didn't. And so oftentimes we as Christians, we walk around not knowing the circumstances of what's out there to protect them. Guys, doesn't mean we're not going to go through, doesn't mean that the battle's not going to look real or feel real or be real, but it's...
You know what I love about that whole, is it Escar? What do they call it?
Escal.
They all come back and said, "Oh, there's no way, we can't go up against them." And the two that said, "We got this," they were the young bucks. They were the ones who hadn't even seen all that the Lord had done, talking to the ones that were the older folk that had seen what all God had done.
Right.
You know, so...
And forgotten.
And forgotten, overtaken by circumstances. There's a message in that, guys. We need our youth. Because we lose our zeal.
Right.
And the youth will come in with zeal. Well, youth and zeal equals stupidity a lot of times.
Amen.
So, okay, hey, y'all, watch this. You know? So, They need the older ones to temper their zeal with wisdom of, that's too big for you to jump on a skateboard, son. Okay? And I think that we, with the gray hairs, need their zeal to remind us who we are. We can't get by without them, and they can't get by without us. We need them. Verse 7, then after that saith he to his disciples, let us go into Judea again. His disciples say unto him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and goest thou thither again? Okay. There's the limits Misty was talking about. Lord, Jesus. Now remember, the disciples had seen quite a bit up into that point. And there we are again. If we can just get through this trial, when they'd already come through, they'd already witnessed many. Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him. These things saith he, and after that he saith unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. This again is something that we mentioned last week when I was sharing with you about one that stands in the gap is one that will put himself in danger so that another might live or so that another might receive. Then said his disciples, now listen to this. I don't know why. I have a sick sense of humor. I know that about me. I know that. I recognize it. I own it. I know it. I actually laughed out loud when I read this next verse. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Just leave him alone, Lord. He's sleeping. He's peaceful. Rest in peace, Lazarus. What was going on here is they didn't want to go back because they weren't worried about Jesus being killed. They were worried about them being killed because they were with Jesus. And then they're going to, and then in their own twisted, sick human thinking, like we all do, they're thinking, well, we've been preaching that if, you know, to be dead and, you know, Christ, when you die, you'll be with Christ. And so he's already sleeping. He's resting in peace. He was a good man. He loved you. He knew you. He's on your side. You're on his. Everything is good. There's no need for us to go back. I don't know. I just thought, that is so like us. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Let him alone, Lord. Howbeit, Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking a rest in sleep. Okay? Now, I see what this is saying. In that they were confused on whether he was dead, whether he was sleeping. But.
So when he went to heaven and came back?
He was dead.
Right.
The Bible doesn't say where he went during that slumber or that sleep that I'm aware of.
Purgatory.
Abraham's bosom. Paradise. Then Jesus said unto them, so then Jesus plainly says to them, okay, Lazarus is dead. Cleared up any confusion whether he was sleeping, whether he was dead. And he says, and I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there to the intent that ye may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Now, I don't know whether Thomas was going, all right, well, let us go so that we might as well go. We're going to die anyway. Or I don't know if he's going, we'll go with him and we'll die with him. I don't know. But he was the doubting Thomas up until a little bit later on. So I'm venturing to say that he would have probably done just like us and went, well, let's go. And we go into ministry that way sometimes. I know I do. Okay, I'm not telling the nursery again. But I'm doing it for you, Lord. I'm doing it for you. When Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off. And many of the Jews came to Mary and Martha to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Remember, we do know from Mary and Martha's spirit, from what we've read earlier about them, Martha was the type A personality. She was the one that got things done. She was the one that took charge. She was the one that fixed everything. And Mary was that quiet spirit that received. And so here we got another version of those personalities. Martha running out to meet Jesus. Mary waiting at the house. Sitting still. And it reminds me of the, was it Psalm, I think it's Psalm 46 and 10 that says, "Be still and know that I'm God." Amen. Mary was resting in him. Martha had to get to him. And I think that we, probably all of us, are one of those two personalities. I think Martha gets a lot of stigma put on her for being wrong. I don't think she was wrong. I think the Lord was working with her personality, just like he was working with Mary with hers. Because in this room, whether you be male or female, we have Marys and we have Marthas. We have some that when you guys, some of you face trials, you just sit quietly and rest in him, knowing that he's going to show up on the scene. You got other of us that'll go into our prayer call and say, "Lord, are you listening? Lord, are you listening? He's in Mexico, Lord, for you. Let him get across the border with those Bibles." God doesn't waste either one of those. He doesn't waste either one of those. Then said Martha unto Jesus, "Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it to thee." And you know, at first when I read this, read over this to study it, my first thought was she was accusing him. But then when I really got to reading it, what she was saying is she was saying, "I have double faith in you." She was saying, even though she didn't understand it and it was coming across with her human understanding, "Lord, I want you to know that if you'd have been here, he would not have died. But because you weren't, now he's going to live again." Or whatever you ask, God will give it to you. "But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee." Now, I love the fact that this right here tells you that Mary and Martha had spent some time learning from Jesus. Because one of the things that Jesus tried to teach while he was on earth is that, "I don't do anything of myself. What I do of the Father. What I do of the Father." Evidently, somewhere Martha had received that, because she said, "Whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee." She knew. There was something in her that had some understanding of who he was, who his Father was, and the relationship between them. Jesus saith unto her, verse 23, "Thy brother shall rise again." Martha saith unto him, "I know that he shall arise again in the resurrection at the last day." Now, here's another thing I love about this whole passage here. Evidently, Martha is conflicted. Okay? And it gives us a better understanding of how we are as humans, how we struggle with our faith, because Martha had just said to him he would not have died. "But anything you ask, God will give you." And then Jesus says, "Okay, thy brother shall rise again." And she's like, okay, Jesus is on the scene. That's not what she said. She said, "Oh, yeah, I know he'll raise later." So she's doing what seemingly is doing this. Jesus said unto her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this?" And she said unto him, "Yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world."
Amen.
And when she had so said, she went her way and called Mary her sister secretly, saying, The master is come and calleth for thee. As soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. Now Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in that place where Martha had met him. Verse 31. The Jews then, which were with her in the house and comforted her, when they saw Mary that she rose up hastily and went out, they followed her, saying, She goeth unto the grave to weep there. Then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and said, Where have ye laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. Now there's a whole lot of speculation about what Jesus was crying about. I've heard it said that he was crying because they were hurting. I've heard it said that he was crying because Lazarus was dead. I can't really get either of those versions because, number one, he already knew they were hurting. And he put it off going for a few days. He put off going for a few days. I don't think it was fleshly emotion. I think the weeping came from deep in the spirit. And I don't think it was because Lazarus was dead. Because he knew what he was getting ready to do. And to be absent with the body is to be present with the Lord. And I don't believe that he was crying because they were hurt. I believe it more the other way I've heard it, that he was crying because of the lack of understanding and the lack of faith. Then said the Jews, Behold how he loved him. And some of them said, Could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus, therefore, again groaning in himself. I think that he was troubled and that he was hurting and that he was groaning because of the lack of faith and the lack of understanding and the lack of depth of these people that he had walked with and talked with for this amount of time. It was a cave and a stone lay upon it. Verse 39, Jesus said, Take ye away the stone. Again, this is one of those things where you don't know why Jesus does the things he does. Why didn't he just wave his hand? You know, why didn't he just wave his hand and the stone roll away? Maybe because he needed them to put feet on their faith. Because I've never had to roll a stone away, but I'm pretty sure it's probably a little bit of heavy work. Jesus said, Take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he hath been dead 4 days. Have you ever done that? Have you ever knew that the Lord was going to fix a situation? Had absolutely 100% surety in that. But then when he starts to move, you questioning to see if he's doing it right.
Clarifying the situation.
Lord, are you sure you know what you're doing? Maybe I'm the only one that thinks these things. I don't know. Maybe I'm the only one that, you know, I've often said I am the modern day Peter. I am the problem child. I am the one that questions everything, that argues everything.
It frustrates me, like my grandmother passing, of course, you know, we know where she's going, but she worked her whole life to get to where she's at. But yet, you know, we grieve for missing her because that's the flesh in us, but we should be happy where she's at.
Right.
She's where she worked so hard to get to.
You know, I don't know, those of you that have heard of Smith Wigglesworth, I read in his diary, and he talked about his wife was very, very sick, and she was to the point of death, and she took her last breath, and he started pleading with heaven, pleading with heaven, and she took a breath and looked at him and said, why did you do that? Why didn't you let me go?
It's a blessing when
It hurts us. It hurts us.
That should just make us strive to work harder to get there. Mm-hmm.
There you go. Jesus saith unto her, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. Earlier we said, we opened up with prayer, and we said, the Lord knows. We don't have to call out those requests to him, but for the benefit of the others. The ones that sit here and say, why do they mention their sister? Why do they mention their job interviews? Why do they mention their sons? So that others may hear and know whom you trust, whom you believe in, and whose hands you put it in. We know that the Father hears us always, but we speak up, we open our mouth, we share that, we call out to him publicly so that others may believe that he has sent us. We're out of time today. We'll pick it up there next week. You all fellowship for a few minutes. We have a guest in to do our praise and worship this morning. You all make her feel welcome. This is a friend of Shiloh and Alyssa's from their school. Very, very sweet little girl. You all pray for her. I say little girl. She's closing in on 18, but that's little to me. Very talented and precious. Walking anointed word right there.